Okay. Hello, everybody. So this afternoon we begin with Nicolas Bonod from Institut Fresnel at Marseille. We're going to speak about the singularity expansion method and the application to light spectrum.
Exactly. So thank you very much. Good afternoon. It's a real pleasure to be here. I would like to thank Raphael for organizing this workshop. A very interesting week. And for giving me the opportunity to present a part of our research activities that we are carrying out at Institut Fresnel in the south of France, in Marseille. So this is a collaborative work. I would like to cite here Isam, Ben Soltane, who is here. So do not hesitate to interact with Isam. He will be very pleased to present you his research. He has a poster here. Also, a former PhD student, Rémi, who is now in Nice. He works in the topic of metasurfaces. I have a long time collaboration with my colleague from Institut Fresnel, Brian Stout. Okay, and the title, Light Sketching Through the Eyes of the Singularity Expansion Method. Okay, so three parts in this presentation. The first one, it will give you the main context of this study, our motivations, and I will provide a short survey on the theory of light sketching. The second part will be fully devoted to the derivation of the singularity expansion method, and at the end, I will give you a few examples of application of this method to expand mean coefficients and the Fresnel coefficients. I work in the Fresnel Institute, so we have to work with the Fresnel coefficient. Okay, so the first part, context and motivation. Okay, let me remind you this story. So here is Richard Sigmondi, who was awarded the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1925. And so the purple of Cassius is here. It's a solution containing metal colloids. And Richard Sigmondi here showed that this solution, purple of Cassius, consisted of gold colloidal particles. And for that, he developed the so-called ultra microscope. Here is a picture of this ultra microscope with the sunlight here. And now we will call this ultra microscope the so-called dark field microscope. Actually, you just collect the light that is scattered. So if you remove all the scatterers from the solution, light propagates through the solution, but it is not collected, it cannot be collected by the microscope. And in fact, with this microscope, with this technique, you collect only the light that is scattered by the particles contained in the solution. And here is the image that you obtain. So bright spot, each bright spot corresponds to the presence of a nanoparticle. And just tell me, heard about this experiment, heard about the structural coloration of this solution, and he developed the so-called Mie theory. So why is now Mie so famous? What is this Mie theory? And what were the motivation to develop this theory? So here is the Mie seminal paper. Actually, there is only one paper. Everything is described in this unique paper published in 1908. This paper was published in German. So we have two translations in English. And so the translation in English could be, for the title, could be contributions on the optics of turbid media, particularly colloidal metal solutions. So as you can see, this very long paper, 69 long pages of technical mathematical derivations, was aimed only at explaining the structural coloration of solutions. That's it. But his theory was much more general, and at the end, it is currently used in many different topics. But his motivation was to explain. It's a very modest title, contribution. It was a contribution to the physical explanation of this structural color. To illustrate this, let me show you the very first sentence of this paper. As you can see, it's all about coloration. The various colorations of metal in the colloidal state have a different interpretation at different times, and then he derives his theory. At the end, equation 55 of this paper, we get here the expression, the analytic expression of the so-called Mie coefficient. As you can see, so we could summarize this, this approach by the following sketch here. Actually, here you can solve Maxwell equations in spherical coordinates, but at the end, everything behaves as is here. You will place at the center of the sphere here an infinite set of multiples, electric and magnetic multiples. Okay? And outside the boundary, the field is the same. Okay? So this finite size scatterer behaves as point-like scatterers placed located here at the center of the sphere. And you can retrieve with this approach the field that is scattered outside the sphere. Okay? So here is the notation that we use in our lab. So the so-called electric here, A, N, and the order of the multiple, and magnetic, B. And once again, we have N for the order of the multiple. And these Mie scattering coefficients are very useful because with this, we can calculate the optical cross-section. So the Mie theory, the success of the Mie theory is that you have long derivation, but that can be very technical, but at the end, you have the expression of the Mie coefficients A and B, with which you can retrieve very easily the optical cross-section, extension cross-section, scattering cross-section. So that the reason why this Mie theory is widely used. Okay. And now, if I consider, now what is the link with our topic is that right now, in modern nanophotonics, people work with very small scatterers, resonant scatterers, as in the initial solution of the purple of the Cassius with Richard Segmondi. At the end, it was it was composed of nanoparticles, okay, that were hosting electromagnetic resonances. So we will consider the following small particles, smaller than the wavelength. And for that, we will consider actually the first multiples, okay? They will predominate over the high order multiples. Yesterday, we saw with rainbows, with the droplets, water droplets, that if with millimeter size particles, you have to consider high order multiples, but with sub-wavelength scale particles, A1 or B1 are sufficient. Okay? So here is an example of we can plot in the case of a silver nanoparticle in the visible spectrum, A1 and A2, so dipole, quadrupole here. And you can see here the excitation of this so-called plasmonic resonance. So what is interesting is that you can define what we call the unitary limit. We want to determine the composition of the scatterer that will maximize the scattering. So for that, we impose that this electric Mie coefficient here is equal to 1. And we have to find here the dielectric permittivity of the scatterer that will satisfy this condition. So the material that will maximize the scattering, okay, for this given channel, electric dipole channel. So you can solve this equation here, and at the end you will find two solutions. And in the case of dipole, with this expression here can be solved analytically. And we can find analytically the expression of the dielectric permittivity of the scatterer that will maximize the scattering. Okay? And actually you will find two solutions, actually two different materials that are able to maximize the scattering. The first one is a metal. So with, for example, with silver, this is the diameter, this is the wavelength. You can set this diameter, 15 nanometers, the wavelength, the electric permittivity of silver at this wavelength. And at the end, you can find that A1 is, okay, it is very close to 1. Okay, so it's a so-called plasmonic resonance. It is due to the fact that this metal here has 3 electrons that explain the negative part of the real part of the dielectric permittivity. But actually, you can find the second solution. The second solution, the second dielectric permittivity for which this condition is satisfied. And in this case, you find that the dielectric permittivity here equal to 100 here provides the same coefficient here. Okay? So on the left you have a metal, on the right you have a dielectric. So in other words, here you have 3 electrons, it's a conductor, but here it's an insulator here. But both provide the same optical response. Okay? Two different materials, two different scatterers, but the same optical response. Because in the two cases here, all the other multipoles can be safely negligible. It means that the optical response is determined by this coefficient here. So you can make the numerical experiment. You consider a scatterer here that you eliminate by plane wave. You calculate the electric field distribution here around the particle. And this scatterer behaves as an electric dipole. That's the reason why in the near field here is maximum here and here. And in the far field, the field is scattered in this direction here. Okay. Now you can do the same thing for an insulator, for a dielectric, and this is the result. So the field inside the scatterer is completely different, but outside the scatterer, it is exactly the same as here. So it means that dielectrics here can also host electromagnetic resonance. The case of silver and gold was very well known with this historical experiment that motivated the development of the new theory. But we can see here that dielectrics can also host electromagnetic resonances. Actually, you can find an infinite set of values, but for the dielectric case, the real part will be still higher. As the first solution here, 100, is already high, we stop there. So let me briefly present you the main result on this topic, very interesting topic, mere resonances. The resonances that can be excited with dielectrics. Okay? So, in 2002, the main motivation at this time was to develop negative index materials. And for that, people wanted to develop magnetic materials. Okay? But in 2006 here, this group here in Stanford showed that high permittive materials here with epsilon larger than 40, but without intrinsic magnetism, was able here to get a magnetic resonance, and they were able to show that the effective magnetism mu here was negative. So they were able to get simultaneously negative epsilon and mu. And there was also this. But you can see that epsilon larger than 40 is still high. And in the visible spectrum, you will not be able to find such high dielectric permittivity. But in almost 10 years ago, two papers were published. It's not this one. This paper was published, and in this paper, they consider a silicon with the dielectric permittivity around 16. Okay, so a silicon sphere, so silicon is ubiquitous in microelectronics, it's a very abundant material, and the delta permittivity of 16 is enough actually to get here a strong resonance of the B1 coefficient, the dipolar magnetic coefficient. If you remember, the mean theory has electric and magnetic coefficients. And with silicon here, you are able to excite this magnetic dipolar coefficient. This is a resonance of the magnetic dipole in the sphere. So mere resonances are very interesting because they can host both magnetic and electric resonances. They feature small losses compared with metals, okay? And you can excite magnetic dipoles, electric dipoles, magnetic dipoles there, and you can combine both. So it offers you many opportunities to control the properties of light scattering. Because if in the scatterer you are able to excite simultaneously electric dipole and magnetic dipole with the same amplitude, they are coherent, so you can control, for example, the back scattering. And this is a very interesting property with a very simple silicon sphere. So this paper here triggered a huge interest and then a series of very interesting studies. So here are the two papers that were published, 2010, 2011 here. So very simply, they consider a silver sphere, they calculate the magnetic dipole, the electric dipole here, and they show both here that they can excite a magnetic dipolar resonance here, here and here. So very similar plots. And here, what is interesting is that here is the refractive index of the sphere. So you can see here that if you increase this refractive index, you sharpen the resonances, okay? But it means also that for dielectric permittivity or refractive index near 2.5, it's already there. You have here the magnetic resonance here. So, as I told you, many applications, and we can come back to this topic of structural colors as the doctor cases, but here with purely dielectric particles. For example, in my group, we reproduce at a short scale this Mondrian painting only with silicon particles, hosting dipoles, electric and magnetic dipoles. But after that, we had many studies and results very, very impressive. For example, this one is this is the palette of colors that you can get with silicon particles only by controlling the shape of the particles. You control the scattering spectrum and then the final color. So let me compare the two results. 1850, this purple of Cassius, composed of metal colloids. And in 2020 here, this paper showed here ink made of silicon particles. And here, it's not a purple of Cassius, but it's a solution containing silicon spherical particles. But the interest was, so I showed you the interest for in the historical frame, we say, but the interest goes much farther. For example, with this resonance, you can enhance the near field here. These nanoparticles made of silicon will behave as electric dipole. And in the near field of electric dipole, the field can be strongly enhanced. So if you, for example, consider this experiment, you have a water solution containing small fluorescent particles that you want to probe. By coupling here silicon particles, you are able to detect here the presence of these fluorescent molecules and to enhance their fluorescent emission. Okay, this was a study. So previously I showed you the interest in the far field. Here I show you the interest in the near field, just in the direct vicinity of the particle. But there is also a very interesting field of research because you can enhance the field inside the particle. And if you are able to enhance the field inside, you will be able to enhance the nonlinear response of the material. If you consider a material that has nonlinear properties, if you enhance the field with this resonance inside the scatterer, you can create third harmonic generation, second harmonic generation, or four-wave mixing also. By this approach, you can modify the frequency of the wave that is scattered. You can multiply it by three or by two this frequency, or by this approach, you can control here the frequency of the light that is emitted here. This is a collaborative work between our group and Australia. And we were able here to, with two beams in the near infrared, so invisible by with eyes, you can here generate a signal in the visible. And you, so in this case, the resonance inside the scatterer enhances the conversion efficiency. Okay, this was the first part. So as you can see, we want now to control this resonance, because this resonance opens many applications. And in my group, we want to understand the spectrum, the response of the scatterer. And this is the reason why we focused our attention on the so-called singularity expansion method. So if I come back to the mean scattering coefficient here, if we calculate this term here in the complex plane, so we will find solution here. So this will be the singularities. So let me show you here the complex frequency plane here. The singularities here of electric and magnetic dipoles. So electric dipoles in blue and magnetic dipole in red here. So as you can see, there is an infinite set of singularities. Here, you can notice here that for the magnetic case, this singularity is located on the imaginary axis. So no real part, just a purely imaginary part. In both cases, here, you have the first singularity is far below the complex plane. So it means that the imaginary part here is important. And then you have a set of singularities just underneath here the real axis, so for which the imaginary part is much lower. And here, so, okay, so everything is there. So, but now the motivation, we would like to, so with these singularities in the complex plane, we can understand that if we excite this scatterer along with the frequency along this real axis, the optical response will be driven by these singularities. But now we want to derive the expression of this mean coefficient as a function here of these singularities. So before that, just a few words. The mean coefficients are linear transfer functions. Singularities are just complex frequencies for which the transfer function becomes infinite. And the objective here is to expand this linear transfer function in terms of the singularities. So let me mention also that this work started a long time ago in the 70s here, for example with Carbon, also Patrick Vincent in Marseille worked on this topic. So here is so we are interested here by this linear transfer function here in the harmonic domain. So we can consider in the time domain first a temporal input here. We have the system here that provides the response, but we can work in the harmonic domain. And here we typically in photonics we consider this case here, for which we excite the system. The system can be an optical component or a scatterer at a given wavelength, and we calculate the optical response. And the objective is to retrieve the optical response as a function of the singularity of this transfer function. And the transfer function, in the case of a sub-wavelength scatterer, is the mean coefficient. If you consider an interface, it will be the reflection, the Fresnel coefficient, etc., etc. So now, I will focus on this linear transfer function H omega. So this is, as I showed you, this function as singularities in the complex frequency plane. So it's a meromorphic function. And so we are interested here in expressing this linear transfer function in this frequency omega here, as a function of the singularities in the complex plane. So we can use the Cauchy integral theorem that is summarized here. So briefly, you can get this function here as a function of this function in this circle around gamma c. But if you increase the size of gamma c, you will get singularities. And the reason why you have to incorporate the residue theorem. So you can consider two different contours. The first one that just around this frequency omega, and the second one much larger that contains the singularity. So this one gives you the function h of omega. This is the function that we want, but now we have to apply the residue theorem. So we have to apply the residue theorem, not on h, but on h over z minus omega. This is the main difficulty of this work. Okay. So let me summarize. So this is what we get here. And at the end, we have to calculate this residue of r. But r, let me remind you that it is h over z minus omega. And this is the main difficulty here. So so for that, we can calculate the Laurent expansion of h and the Taylor expansion of this function 1 over z minus omega. I will try to give you the main steps of this derivation. This is the Laurent expansion, okay. L is the order of the singularity, okay. P. So L is the order, P is the singularity, the complex frequency, H is the linear transfer function. So this is the Laurent expansion of this transfer function. And mu here is the order of the singularity. We can make a Taylor expansion of D, okay. We get this. Expansion and this one. This is a Taylor expansion. We can combine both because R, I remind you that it is H over Z minus omega, so it's H times G. And we have here, so we can combine both. But we can also consider the Laurent expansion of R directly. And then we can compare these two expansions that have to be similar, and at the end, that will allow you to find the expression of this Laurent coefficient here of R as a function of the Laurent coefficient of H. And okay, so at the end, this is what you get here. But L here, I remind you that so this is the expression, but L has to be larger than the order of the singularity. Okay, and M here has to be, so this is a Taylor expansion, so M has to be positive. So it means that L has to be smaller than M and L larger than minus M. So you can replace here these values by these two bonds here. This is what you get. And this allows you to get the Laurent expansion of Laurent coefficient of R as a function, it's a sum of the Laurent coefficient here of H. But now, the residue of R is defined as the Laurent coefficient with n equal to minus 1. So you can replace n here by minus 1, and this is the result. Okay, so now if I come back to the initial, so this is the result. But if I come back to the initial Cauchy theorem and residue theorem, this is what the problem. And so what I told you is that the difficulty was to get the expression of the residue of R, because as a function of the residue of H, and this is what we get here. So we just have to replace this expression here by this one, and this is the final expression, the singular expansion of H of omega. And that's it. So here you have H omega that can be retrieved as a function of the singularity P, and here the Laurent coefficient of H. Just a few words about this integral here. So if this condition here, if H does not diverge when Z tends toward infinity, okay? So it's a well-behaved function. So we can say here that when this contour integral becomes large here, then we can replace omega by a given frequency A, the complex plane, and this allows us to get this expression here. So in a few words, what we get here is that H of omega can be obtained. So usually A is an arbitrary function. So what we do is that we consider this the zero frequency. So A is equal to zero. So you replace A by zero. And this is what we call the non-resonant term. The term that estimates the singularities that are not taken into account into our contour, plus the singularities that are taken into account. So let me briefly remind you. So we consider an optical system here, or defined by a linear transfer function f h of omega, excited by an incoming field, which want to retrieve the response of this linear transfer system as a function of the singularities here of this system. And so this is the expression that we get. So I will try in the following. So also one word about the physical constraints. I will not enter into the details, but all the singularities we consider passive systems and causality. So in this case, we can see that the singularities all have a negative imaginary part. And you can notice also the symmetry of the location of these singularities with respect to the imaginary axis. So one word also about the phase. As you can see, the phase rotates by 2 pi over each singularity. And this is very important in photonics, for which the control of the phase of light, of the beam, is very important. And as you can see here, with only one singularity, the phase, so the contour around each singularity has a 2 pi phase shift. So it's very convenient, because with resonant scatterers, you can tailor the phase of the beam, of the incoming beam. Okay, so let me show you the application of this approach. So first, I will come back to the initial problem, a scatterer, and we will try to retrieve the electric dipolar coefficient, okay? So this is the slide that I've showed you, the original equation taken from the Mies paper. And we are interested in the following by A1. So here is the optical response when we calculate the scattering cross-section here of silicon sphere. As I told you, silicon sphere are very interesting because they have many resonances, and they are very easy to fabricate right now. And you can have both electric and magnetic resonances. So here is the total scattering when you enhance. This is the parameter size, it's just a ratio between the diameter of the scatterer and the wavelength. So this is the magnetic resonance, magnetic dipolar resonance, electric dipolar resonance, magnetic quadrupolar resonance, etc., etc. And here is, so as I told you, the electric dipolar resonance. So this is the spectrum of the electric dipole here, with the gray dashed line here, okay? And what is very interesting here is that you can notice that just after the maximum here, this coefficient goes towards zero. And a few years ago, but not so long, I would say 6 years ago, there was a big interest with this paper here, because this mis-scattering coefficient was tending towards zero, and the total scattering coefficient here, total scattering of the sphere, was very, very small. So you have a resonance scatterer, but it does not scatter light. But the question was, at this time, if you calculate the field inside the scatterer, the field was not negligible. So you have a scatterer that does not scatter light, so light propagates through the scatterer, but light is still confined. So there is a distribution of internal current, okay, due to the polarization of matter excited by the incoming electric field of light. But this distribution of polarization drives to a field that is not scattered. This is what they call anapole. And so what they say, hey, anapole could be very interesting to enhance light matter interaction. I have a scatterer that is able to confine light inside, but it does not scatter light. So we use anapole to enhance light matter interaction inside the scatterer. So at this time, with my former PhD student, we wanted to use this approach of singularities to explain the physics of anapole. So let me remind you the distribution of singularity of mirror resonances here. So here we consider the electric dipole, so the blue singularity here, the blue point. And we want to retrieve with this singular expansion here, this is the so-called non-resonant term plus the sum of singularity and residues here. And we can plot here this term for each singularity. So this one is for the fundamental singularity far below, so it's this one. This one. So it's far below, the imaginary part is large, the quality factor is not so good. The second one is here. As you can see, they share the same real part here. So the maximum of the two responses are very close, okay? They do not share the same shape, but they share the same frequency maximum. But when you sum the coherent summation, when you sum the two contributions, you can see that they negatively interfere and this kills this response. Now, if you add these three terms here, this one plus this one for the two singularities, you observe this response here. So the first conclusion of this slide is that with this expansion and by considering a large number of singularities, you can retrieve the full spectrum of the mi coefficient. Okay? And you can retrieve the fact here that this mi coefficient goes towards zero. And with only a few sets of singularities, here only two, you are able to explain why here this coefficient here goes towards zero. But actually, we were able to explain the fact that actually, at this zero, the field was not maximum. The field is maximum at the real part of the singularity. But okay, I will take 2 minutes to show you the application of this approach for the Fresnel coefficient. So in this case, we consider a simple slab here, thickness d, refractive index n. Okay, so here are the expression of the reflection at a slab. Very well known, these expressions can be taken into any textbook. okay, we take this expression, and we consider even an odd mode here. So, briefly speaking here, you can get SE and S even and S odd here as a function of this expression. So, from this expression, it's very easy to calculate poles and residues. Okay? And the good point here with SLAB is that everything can be derived analytically. You can calculate all the poles and singularities analytically. So this is the singularity expansion method with this non-resonant term plus the Lorentzian function here with the even and odd frequencies that can be calculated analytically, and then you plug these frequencies here. Okay, this is the singularities in the complex plane that you plug, and the residues can also be calculated very easily. What we can do here is that once we have this singularity expansion method here, we can with an inverse Fourier transform, we can with this expression we can retrieve the Fresnel coefficient. So I do not show you the conversion, it's pretty fast, and we can retrieve the optical response of this slab. But then we want to go further and try to find the response in the time domain. So for that, we perform this inverse Fourier transform of the reflective field. I try to skip the details. But at the end, what we find is that it's a convolution, as it was expected, between this impulse response function, whose expression is obtained as a function of the singularity, and the incoming field. So you have the reflective field is a convolution, the time domain is a convolution between the excited field and the impulse response function. So what is great is that you calculate one the impulse response function, okay, and then you can calculate the response for any incoming field. So let me show you the conversion as a function of the singularities that we consider. So this is the total field with this Fourier expansion. We compare with CST calculation, so it's completely different, and we calculate the difference as when we increase the number of poles that are considered in the simulation. So what is great in this expression is that, for example, let me show you the expression of the transmitted field. As the transmitted field, with this expression separates intrinsically the transient and the steady state. This is the steady state. We have the full expression of the steady state. And as you can see here, in the steady state, we do not have the expression of the poles, but the poles here are linked, appear in the expression of the transient regime. It means here you can plot and separate the plot of the transient state from the steady state. And the poles contribute only to the transient state here, that you can see here. Okay, we also work in the case of a dispersive slab made of metal. We calculate here in the near infrared UV range, okay, the distribution of the singularities, high frequency range, for which when the frequency becomes larger, and we try once again to retrieve the response. Here is the reflection coefficient, the Fresnel coefficient, when increasing the number of singularities from the complex. Okay, so with that, let me just conclude. So the singularity expansion method provides a response of an optical system thanks to singularity. So it can be applied to a large set of optical systems. In this talk, I consider very simple cases, such as a sphere with a mean coefficient or a slab, but we also apply this formalism to more complicated cases, the so-called research field of metasurfaces, composed of complicated plasmonic nanostructures here. So it can be applied to any linear transfer function, such as the mean coefficient, S-matrix coefficient, etc., etc., and it works in both harmonic and time domain, and you can extend it to singularity of any other. With that, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. So maybe a quick question before we skip. Yes?
Okay, in this case, in the when we calculate the scattering cross section, we consider only one scatterer. So there is no coupling effect. So it will work in very dilute solution. Yes. You will have to consider the coupling between between the different scatterers. Yes.
For the pole that is on the imaginary axis, do you see some fields due to this guy?
Yes, it's a very interesting point. Actually, I would like to investigate this very surprising property. We have a pole on the imaginary axis, and at this moment, so my first, we can expect that this pole will contribute to the response when omega tends towards zero, and when we calculate the optical cross section, we do not see the influence of this singularity. So right now, I would like to investigate this problem and how to. I would like to engineer the excitation of the field in the time domain in order to excite this singularity. Yes, and I believe that it is a very interesting property. Yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you
very much.